Hello. In this video, we'll look at how to create a static website on Google Cloud Platform. Let's very quickly create a diagram to understand what we're trying to achieve, and then we'll jump in to the Google Cloud Console to set up these cloud resources. Cloud storage is going to be the foundation for our website. This service will handle storing and serving our static website files. We can have HTML, CSS, and client-side JavaScript, but not back-end code like PHP or Python. We're also going to layer on Cloud CDN. This will make our website very fast as we'll be able to cache some of those static files on the edge of Google's global network. When we set this up, we'll also showcase how to use SSL certificates for secure, encrypted networking. Specifically, we'll leverage the Cloud Load Balancing Service and Google-managed SSL certificates. A quick reminder here. When we say static website, we mean a website with only HTML, CSS, and client-side JavaScript. So, for example, you can't use PHP or other server-side technologies in this architecture. Static doesn't mean that the website can't have animations, navigation, or customization. It just means that you'll need to use only client-side JavaScript for coding those things into the website. Okay, so just to be clear now with the website flow. Before our users are served our website files on cloud storage, they'll pass through the cloud load balancing and potentially hit a cache of our static files. Cloud storage will be used to serve uncached website file requests. Great, so let's go ahead and set this up. The first thing that we're going to do in the Google Cloud Console is go to cloud storage. You can either navigate there using the panel on the homepage or by finding the cloud storage in the main menu. We're going to create a bucket and match the name to the planned domain for the website. In our example, that is hello.notomatic.io. Note that we'll need to verify our domain in just a moment. We're going to use a US bucket and the standard storage class. This selection is actually important. The standard storage class means that we're going to pay less when the data is accessed frequently. For example, archive storage has lower storage costs, but higher access costs, so would end up being much more expensive for our website use case. For the website to be available on the public internet, we need to configure public access on our bucket, including unchecking this setting and choosing a uniform access policy here. We'll go ahead and skip versioning and a retention policy, but these settings might be interesting for your specific use case. When I try to create the site, we see a pretty standard error here. The error suggests that we need to verify the domain name, proving we own it before it can be used. So let's click here and see how we can verify this domain. When we open Google Search Console, we can start to set this up. We're going to use the standard text verification method. Now we need to add this DNS record in our DNS provider console. Let's do that in a new tab here. Cloud DNS will be under Network Services. You don't need to use Google Cloud DNS for this. If you're using a different DNS provider, that's completely fine. The point is just to add this text record wherever you manage your domain. All right, so we're following the instructions here to add that text record. With that record now in place, we can click Verify, and we're good to go. Our ownership has been verified. Let's go back to the bucket creation page and click Create. We have our bucket now. Note that we have public access currently off. We're going to change that to make our website accessible on the internet. Navigate to the permissions page and grant access. Make sure that the access is just for the website bucket. For the principal, select all users. That means with even unauthenticated users, we'll have this access. For the role, we want to choose Object Reader. It will double check with us to make sure that we want to allow everyone and anyone to read files in this bucket. Okay, so now we have our bucket set up. If we return to our reference architecture, we see that the only networking components still need setup: Cloud Load Balancing and Cloud CDN. So from here, let's go to Networking Services and then Load Balancing. We'll create the load balancer, and remember, we're going to highlight how to use HTTPS for an SSL certificate secured website. We specifically want the global HTTPS load balancer and the non-classic version. For our HTTPS redirect, we need to have a static IP. So we'll provision one here. In the certificate setup, we're going to use the easiest option here, which is to have Google manage this certificate for us. Okay, so that looks good. We have our redirect for the load balancer now, and we're going to need a backend bucket next. This backend is going to use the bucket that we just set up, and we're going to enable Cloud CDN for content caching on the edge. We're going to use the default configurations for the caching, which caches only certain types of content. You can consult the documentation to understand exactly what files, under what conditions, are cached. We don't need any of the advanced options here, and we don't need things like CloudArmor as a web application firewall. Finally, in the routing, we see a pretty simple routing setup. Specifically, we want to route all requests to that backend bucket. Now that everything is looking good, we can go ahead and create. Great, the load balancer is now created. It will look like two different load balancers in the Cloud Console, one running HTTP and one running HTTPS. In reality, though, this is effectively just one load balancer. As an important last step for the networking, we need to add one more DNS record. We take the IP from our load balancer and create an A record for it in our DNS system. Once again, this DNS step could be outside of Google Cloud if you'd prefer. This last step makes sure that Google Cloud can provision that SSL certificate and therefore secure our website with HTTPS, since Google will use the HTTP ACME challenge to provision our certificate. This could actually take some time. If I go into the load balancer here and we click on the certificate, we'll see that it's provisioning. Google warns us that this could take up to 24 hours to provision. In our experience, though, it's a much quicker process. Hang tight for probably about 5 to 8 minutes here, and then you should have a certificate that's up and running. As it's provisioning, we can return to our bucket and actually drop in website files. The cloud resources are all set up, but we still need to add our website files and set a related configuration using a Google Cloud CLI command. Okay, so we're going to use a really simple HTTP-only website here, but you could add more files, including CSS and JavaScript, if you need to. To quickly set up the index.html file and a related configuration which tells Google to use that index.html file for folder-level requests, we can use the Google Cloud Shell. This is a free service and basically gives us a little terminal and IDE. In a production scenario, you probably already have your static website files ready to go on your local laptop or on some other cloud-based storage mechanism. In that case, you would just need to copy in the files here, either from this Cloud Console or by using the Google Cloud CLI. But since we don't have that yet, we will open the editor here. Create a new file and paste in some code. We're also going to save that file as index.html. All right, now we have our syntax highlighter to show that it is a working HTML file. Let's go ahead and also upload this file while we're at it. So back to our bucket, we want to switch to the terminal here and use gsutil to copy the file to our bucket. If you get this message, just go ahead and authorize. This is the format of the command that we need. This is copying the HTML file from our local cloud shell to the cloud storage bucket. And if we now refresh, we'll see that index.html file right there. So we're ready to wrap up with the Google Cloud CLI command that tells Google to use this file for the website. Before we do that, let's do a very quick check on our certificate provisioning. Again, we go to load balancing and navigate to the certificate from there. Okay, so we're still provisioning and it's been about 5 minutes, so we'll give it a couple more minutes while we finish our last configuration step. It's not obvious that this step is needed. However, it is in fact required to set up this bucket for web hosting and to provide Google Cloud with configuration details. I'll paste in the templated command here. Looking at the format of the command, we need to specify which file is going to serve requests for the main page. And in our case, that's going to be the index.html file. We're going to skip the error page here, but this could be something like a 404 HTML file. Finally, we need to specify the bucket name. Great. Everything looks good. It took a few more minutes, maybe 8 to 10 or so, for our certificate, but we do have that now. So we have an active SSL certificate. Again, to reiterate, the certificate will never provision if you don't set up an A record to the load balancer IP, like we did earlier in our DNS. Without that setup, Google Cloud cannot provision the certificates using the HTTP ACME challenge. In any case, we should now be good to test our setup by navigating to hello.nodematic.io. We're going to initially get an error, so let's go ahead and give it another minute or two. We very often need to do this last bit of waiting. In Chrome, we actually do have the website working nicely, so we should be able to see the same in Safari quite soon. While we wait for the website to be accessible in Safari, let's go ahead and take a quick look at the costs associated with this setup. As a friendly reminder, if you don't need this website long term, you're definitely going to want to turn it off to avoid cloud costs. But let's see what those cloud costs actually look like if you decide to keep the website up. So on the cloud load balancing front, this is actually where most of the costs are going to come from. It's about $18 per month for this service, and that's up to 5 forwarding rules, which we are well under in the showcase setup. This one's going to be negligible. We can keep it at about zero. The cloud storage is going to be pretty small as well, maybe $1 to $3 for low traffic websites, so let's maybe call that $3. Let's call this about $3 as well. So grand total for our website, we're coming in at about $24. That's a per month cost. Especially if you look at the cost of performance for this sort of setup, this is pretty good. Cloud CDN is going to provide really quick responses to user requests, including if we have quite a bit of multimedia content like images on our static website. Cost and performance are based on the traffic level and use case, so take these estimates with a grain of salt. Now, if I go back to that Safari page just to test things out, there's our Hello World HTML page. We hope this video was helpful, and thank you for watching.